student Stefana Dinova, who has a BA in Architecture from the Technical University in Berlin, and is about to start MA in Architecture at the University of Arts Berlin. And she's speaking about the Barbican Estate in London and the Stavros Niarchos Foundation Cultural Centre in relation to the presence in public space.
Okay, so because there are a couple of motion pictures I would like to show you, I will be kind of jumping from the presentation to the video, and I'm sorry for that, but it doesn't technically work, so yes. Okay, so the spatial experiences of our body and psyche, the memories and fantasies of our mind produces in coloration with these episodes, as well as the time as a human dimension, connecting such events, are subjects of my interest. Through previous design projects at university for public spaces, I recognize the need for a thorough understanding of how these spaces function. We come in contact with them on a daily basis, thus we possess an intuitive understanding of them. With the following research, I try to grasp deeper into the meaning of these spaces beyond my intuitive understanding. The main concern in this research is the influence of public spaces upon our behavior, thoughts, memories, and fantasies. In what way can public spaces influence the dynamic of a society, and what mission should public spaces have? What is the mission of an architect designing such spaces? Using some references from the book Genius Loci, Towards the Phenomenology of Architecture by Christian Schulz, and the essay The Eyes of the Skin by Johanni Palasma, I would like to share some of my thoughts on these questions. So I would like to start. This is one of the buildings I will be I have analyzed. It's the Barbican Estate in London. And as you can see, this is a view towards the courtyard of the Barbican Center. And basic questions which interest me are, for example, what do people do in these public spaces? Why do they go there? What is their goal when they enter this courtyard? And so on. So the search for presentation, I would like to first explain a bit about the notion of place according to Christian Hauberg-Schulz. Then briefly talk about the concept Genius Loci and the essay of Johanni Palasma, The Eyes of the Skin. And then I would like to compare the two buildings. So in his book, Genius Loci, Towards the Phenomenology of Architecture, Christian Hauberg-Schulz defines the notion of place and a man-made place. He points out that by the use of the word place, we refer to something more than an abstract location. We mean a totality made up of concrete things having material substance, shape, texture, and color. Together, these things determine an environmental character, which is the essence of place. In general, a place is given such a character or atmosphere. A place is therefore a qualitative, total phenomenon which we cannot reduce to any of its properties, such as spatial relationships, without losing its concrete nature out of sight. From the beginning of time, man has recognized that to create a place means to express the essence of being. The man-made environment in which he lives is not a mere practical tool or the result of arbitrary happenings. It has structure and embodies meanings. These meanings and structures are reflections of man's understanding of the natural environment and his existential situation in general. Hauberg-Schulz thinks that when the man-made environment is meaningful, he feels at home. In his theory, space is introduced as an existential dimension and not as a mathematical concept. He divides the existential space in two terms, space and character. He describes space as a three-dimensional geometry and as a perceptual field. Centralization, direction, and rhythm are important properties of space. The character is then the general atmosphere. Sorry for the layout. Something went wrong with the when we transfer the file, but this is the concept of genius loci. It's a Roman concept, it derives from the Roman culture, and it basically means the guardian spirit of every independent being, be it a place or a person. It holds, this guardian spirit holds their character or essence and expresses what a thing, being, or is, or what it wants to be. Novak Schulz connects this concept with the aforementioned man-made place. One more interesting essay I read with this for this research was the essay of Palasma, The Eyes of the Skin, in which he talks about the importance of multisensory experience in architecture and criticizes modern architecture as he criticizes that modern architecture is very concentrated to the visual, the way we perceive the building visually. So he says that all the senses, including vision, are extensions of the tactile sense, and he thinks that it is very important that we work with all those five senses when we build spaces. So I'm going to start with the comparison of the Barbican Estate in London and the Stavros Niarchos Foundation Cultural Center. And I would like to keep in mind these definitions and concepts I talked about before. Both of these, I'm interested in the public spaces of both of these buildings. And by comparison, when I'm comparing these two buildings, I do not intend to describe the public space and these buildings as a phenomenological whole. On the contrary, I think that when referring to the perceptive aspects of public spaces, one should only examine the distinct characteristics of different phenomenological states or events that build up the whole, such as material, substance, shape, or color. Public spaces are highly complex architectural constructs, therefore they cannot be described from only one phenomenological aspect. So first of all, I would like to start with briefly talking about the context of the two buildings. So the Barbican Estate was completed in 1982 and is located in the financial center of London. The architects of the building are Chamberlain, Powell, and Bond. And the area was heavily bombed during the Second World War. And after that, there were different proposals for office schemes, but they were all rejected because the city or the corporate people of the plot wanted to also invite back the residents of the city in the center of the city. So the housing scheme of Chamberlain, however, one was the project which was accepted. Because it was supposed to work with, it was supposed to be a complex building of residential spaces and public spaces, and they also needed to design many apartments for the residents. A high density was needed, and the project was developed. Was aimed for those earning mid to high income. This is an image showing the city before the Blitz and the Barbican Estate afterwards. So you can kind of understand the scale of this project and the scale of the rest, like the environment. The Stavros Niarchos Foundation Cultural Center was completed in 2016, and after the architectural firm Rentopiano was chosen during a competition in 2008 to design a space. It was a former parking lot left over from the 2004 Olympic Games. And it was supposed to be developed as the new National Library of Greek and of Greece and the Greek National Opera. It was. It's interesting to know that Stavros Niarchos Foundation donated this project to the city, and it is one of the biggest donations for a cultural center, cultural building known in history. So this is a model of the urban setting of the building. You can see that the building is directly connected. So the blue part, this is the harbor. And the plot is about 4 kilometers away from the city center of Athens. So now that we have created a brief contextual idea of these buildings, I would like to point out some of the characteristics of the buildings influencing our perception of the public space. As I already mentioned, one of the most important functions of the Barbican Estate was to invite back residents into the highly commercialized city center of London. A part of the residential units, the building consists of a concert hall, an art gallery, a theater, a big private garden, a girls' school, an underground parking lot, and a shopping mall. The main architectural elements building up the concept of the building are residential buildings. There are 3 tower blocks, 13 terrace blocks, 2 smaller terrace blocks, and so on. And this is kind of a perspective, a bird's eye view of the Barbican Estate. So we can see the towers and the other residential blocks. And in the middle is the public space, the so-called private garden. The building also has the so-called high walks. This is a network of bridges and narrow walkways. In the Barbican Estate, only pedestrians are allowed, so it's a no-vehicle public space or space. And there are also podiums. This is kind of a new elevated ground. So the first, the ground floor was elevated. So the pedestrians have like this kind of a protected sphere to in which they can navigate. These are the high walks, a photo of a high walk. And also in this building, piloti, inspired by Le Corbusier, were used in order to make the building fluid, so the pedestrians can walk through the whole complex without being hindered by buildings. This is this the principle into the piloti work. So above is a residential building, like a residential unit, but in the like underneath, pedestrians can walk freely. So the building also has many ramps, and the architects have worked a lot with the vertical and verticals and horizontals of the building by using panels. So this is I wanted to show you a video, a movie actually. It's an excerpt of a film by Becker and Lenoir. There are architects who kind of go into public spaces or just buildings and try to document how these spaces are being used. And I hope I can find the right place.
South Bank, lots of cranes over, lots of developments over the Elephant Castle, St. Paul's Cathedral, it's on the market.
This video, I would like to just show you the atmosphere of the building because it's very distinct.
This property is to sell it on the market at 1.85 million. This will be a new high if this price is achieved. With prices in London increasing by the day, I see no reason why it wouldn't go through.
This is the part I wanted to originate.
Thank you.
Barbican Estate, as you already saw on the video, on the first clip I showed, is the light. Yohani Palasma argues in his essay that the imagination and daydreaming are stimulated by dim light and shadow. In order to think clearly, he says, the sharpness of vision has to be suppressed, for thoughts travel with an absent-minded and unfocused gaze. He continues that contemporary public spaces would become more enjoyable through a lower light intensity and its uneven distribution. So there is one last clip I want to show from the video. I just think that using this video shows a lot of these interesting moments in the building and how we perceive it.
Surfaces of this building are very
smooth. So many people come to just rollerblade or ride their bicycles. And one of the other elements is the sloping part I already talked about. And there is also 400 meter long rectangular lake, which you can see on this picture. The park and the lake demonstrate the strong directional properties towards the sea, so they both kind of are directed to the port. The movement in the building is motivated towards the platform and of the site. So by platform I mean this, like the end of the park. So the walls, and I am going to come to the materiality of the building. This is a flying carpet, they call it. It is the roof of public space on top of the park, which is used for different purposes. And there is also a reading lounge looking towards the port. So the the walls and the ceilings are made by exposed polished concrete and immense glass surfaces held by a steel construction. The main colors in the complex are gray and white due to the use of concrete and marble. The light in the building is evenly distributed, making no distinction of function as we saw it in the Barbican. So these are, you can see here, the different materials used and the shapes. It's more of a smooth surface. The concrete and the glass and the steel, these are all reflective materials, which I think is also something very different to the Barbican Center. And the shapes of this building are, in comparison to the Barbican, much more simpler, there is also a predefined rhythm through the whole building, due to the use of steps and ramps and the noisy highway separating the public complex from the port creates a noise cloud, making some areas extremely loud and rather uncomfortable. The public space in the foundation is fluid and doesn't create a mystery for its visitor, in my opinion. Even the reflectiveness of the material doubles some of the properties of the building. The used materials are smooth and create a cold atmosphere. It is a kind of a paradise for these rollerblade people, enthusiasts. So here I wanted to show the materials inside in the interior and how they all reflect the light and So there is a strong sense of orientation in the building due to the simple shapes, and one feels more like it feels more like you can grasp the whole building in a second when you're there. The shapes are very simple, so you kind of understand, okay, there is the opera, there is the library, and there starts the park. And the dynamics are, as I said, there is this highway, so it's not an enclosed public space. It's a very open public space, so you can hear the cars, you can hear the whole city. This is a yoga session on the top of the park, and I was really wondering myself how these people can meditate, because one could hear the whole time the very, very noisy vehicles from the highway. So, also very interesting think I they don't really show it on most of the pictures, the photos of this building, but there is this huge wall looking towards the highway, so it kind of takes the noise away, which I find very interesting as an element, architectural element. So I already talked about the characteristics. And I have thoughts about the building, the Barbican Estate and the Niakos and the foundation. I feel like if you watch the whole movie Barbicania, you kind of understand that there is this anonymity in the Barbican estate, and the residents of the building kind of want to stay anonymous, and they don't want people to go into their apartments or come into their territory, even though the public space is kind of fluidly connected to the residential parts of the areas of the complex. And but at the same time, I feel that because the whole complex was is also the residents of this complex feel like they're kind of in charge of the Barbican estate. They expect that the public spaces carry similar characteristics and of their, like, the way they want to the building to be. They want also the public places of this building to be, and they have a lot of, they have many rules, the residents of the Barbican estate, and they also kind of expect that the visitors obey those rules. Actually the residents have constructed. I find it very interesting that in the foundation you don't really have that, because it's only public space, and it's only for the city. So the visitors of the public areas can kind of define how their behavior is and what they do and so on. And in the Barbican estate, you kind of have these predefined characteristics. And one of my questions would be, in what extent is the architecture in the Barbican microcosmos generating the behavior of anonymity and alienation of the presence and its fantasy of constant observation and control? And in what extent are these characteristics accumulated by the residents themselves? For the Stavros Niarchos Foundation Cultural Center, I feel like the space is very transparent, and you can kind of observe all the people on every specific point, like from each point of the complex. You could observe, constantly observe the behavior of the other visitors, and what is exactly happening in the other parts of the complex. And there is, like, not really that mystery we have in the Barbican Center, and the unexpectedness is not present. And so I feel also like the material, due to the materiality, which is very flat, it kind of suggests, in a way, a superficial observation of the whole complex. And I think that the center successfully uses elements provoking contemplation and reflection of the being, such as the water, the sea, the park. And in my opinion, this building orchestrates a stronger connection of the presence to its natural and urban surroundings in comparison to the Barbican estate, and therefore accumulates thoughts of existence and being not connected to the anonymity. But I was just interested in this. I think it's difficult because these two public spaces or complexes are very they have different layers, and we can kind of observe them from different perspectives. Where these were two things I kind of